Yeah, let's start. So my name is Sam, Sam Richards, and I'm the instructor. I want to say a couple of things about me. So, you know, that's what I looked like when I started teaching this class in 1991. Right before that slide, that's me in the Andes. I spent several years back and forth in rural Ecuador doing research. And so that was, I guess, May of 1990. So I was in the rural areas. So if you see that the house over the on the left in the shoulder, so that was in that house, and I didn't think of that until right now. The people who lived in that house were in Spanish we say campesinos. They were small farmers, and I was sitting on the hillside somewhere around here with a young man. He wasn't so young. He was in his 30s, but who we were sitting watching, and in the sky was an airplane that was going over, right, and leaving contrails, you know, and this guy, his name was Telmo, and Telmo said, ¿Qué es esto? Like, what is that? I'm like, dude, it's an airplane, and Telmo's like, yeah, what? Like, explain it, right? And I'm like, damn, man, and Telmo had only left this valley like a couple times in his life, and that's only to go to a small town a couple hills over, right? So I tell you that story because what I was doing in Ecuador was studying the Catholic Church and what priests and nuns were doing to promote social and economic development with people who are really pretty really really poor. And so I would follow the priests around and, you know, like wherever, up in the hill, you know, like this, right? And it'd just be observing and following what they're doing and getting a sense of it. But in Catholicism, the idea in Christianity is that Jesus is coming again, right? He's going to come. And like this is going to, then God will return in the form of Jesus, the return of Jesus Christ. And this is the Christian ideology. Not all Christians think this or believe it, but, you know, most do. It's part of Christianity. And so people like Telmo, remember, Telmo, ¿qué es esto? Right? Have been hearing from priests their whole lives that Jesus is coming again. Now, in Ecuador, a lot of the more like progressive priests, kind of left progressive priests, where they would portray Jesus as a campesino because as someone who, you know, would look like somebody like the people who lived in this area. But most often, Jesus was portrayed like, can you go back a slide? Like that. Okay. All right. So I would go into villages sometimes in these communities with the priest. And there were several times, you know, we sort of roll in, you know, on horseback or in a car or whatever. And people would say, es él, es Jesús. Like thinking that I'm Jesus, right? Because I came in on the priest and they're in the community and their whole lives, the priest has been saying, Jesus is coming again. That dude comes into the community. So people are like, oh, damn. Padrecito brought Jesus to the community, right? Is that him? Is that, and like, there's nothing more awesome than having people think that you are the return of the Messiah, okay? Let me just start right there. So that's like, if you want to understand, maybe you could score the winning touchdown in the Super Bowl or something, I don't know. But people thinking you're the Messiah, unless, you know, you've taken too much LSD and, you know, you've lost your mind or whatever. But thinking, or they have, but people thinking you're the Messiah is, dude, it's pretty awesome. All right, man. So I just thought I'd tell you that story. All right, man, here's the next thing. All right, that's me with my dad. I've been in iconoclast. I've been outside the box since I was a little kid. So look, my parents are dressing me in pink. Now, pink used to be the masculine color back in the 19th century and very early part of the 20th century, but then it became a feminine color, right? And but, you know, I play with dolls. I wore pink. You know, my parents were cool with that. My dad was older. My mom was older. She was 45 when I was born. And what's important for you to know is I'm not inside of any boxes. Like, I've been outside of boxes since day one. And I teach this class. I think outside of boxes, right? I'm not in any boxes. And I live outside of boxes, and not entirely. I mean, look, I'm dressed pretty traditionally, I guess, right? But it's important because I realized at some point in time, after quite a number of, maybe my second decade of teaching, that I really have been conditioned since I've been a little kid to think like a sociologist and to think outside of the boxes of normality, whatever those are, right? And so there are certain entrapments that we have in life, right? I'm an American, I'm a white guy, I'm from the Midwest. I don't know. I'm mostly straight. I mean, I'm straight. For now, I'm straight, okay? But I'm married, and, you know, if my wife dies before me, then I probably won't be with another woman, right? Because it's just a thing, man. I'm 63. You get to a certain age, it just would be, I just know a lot of men who I'd probably would be with, right? So for right now, I'm straight, okay? So I'm all good. And I'm happy. Like, I mean, it's not like I don't want to be with my wife. I mean, we have a really lovely relationship, right? But in any case, yeah. So the entrapments, I don't know where I was. So there are entrapments, right? So I'm kind of inside, there are certain things I'm in, but I'm not at the same time. I'm really moving in a lot of directions all the time. Okay, so here. It's a miracle that curiosity survives formal education. What that means is that I have this idea that, first off, when my dad was alive, I was a decent student. My dad was really into science and math and so on, and I was then really being pushed towards science and math. But my dad died when I was 9, and then once my dad died, I was on my own because my mom was busy working 3 jobs, and I just basically raised myself, which was pretty awesome. For me, it was awesome. And for other people, it wouldn't necessarily be awesome, but for me, it really was because I had the personality that really thrived, and I probably would have clashed with my dad in lots of ways because once I started to find my freedom. But the point being, I didn't take school seriously. Once he died, I did what I needed to do, and I liked reading. I would go to the library, and I would bring home a stack of books. Like I could go every 2 weeks or sometimes every 3 weeks. I'd bring home a stack of books, and I would just voraciously consume those books. Including I would take them to school and I'd read them at my desk, but I had no interest in doing homework, man, just doing worthless shit homework that doesn't matter. If you think about all the time you've wasted in life just copying stuff down from one thing to another, and it didn't matter. And you're starting to become aware it doesn't matter. Like when you go to your class and your professor puts up slides, and then you write it down in your notebook, and then you memorize it for a quiz or an exam, and then, you know, you spit it back on the exam, and then you empty your brain, and then you go back to class and you start all over again, and none of it stays in your brain, and none of it will stay in your brain. I remember 3 things from my undergraduate education, 3 random factoids at this stage in my life, and that's it. And so for me, it's like, this formal education of just memorizing and emptying our brains out and memorizing more so we can get grades, so that we can jump through hoops, so that we can, I don't know what it is, get a job so that we can work and die. I don't know. But anyway, I just have this idea that I only survived education because I didn't do it well. And I didn't follow the rules. I just sat at my desk and read, and I thought on my own. And then when I started college, so I went to college, and college was inexpensive. I could only get into the University of Toledo. It's the only place they basically let everybody in, so they let me in. I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I didn't really want to go to college, but I did because, I don't know, I just did. And I commuted. I was playing in a band. I was playing music, and I was working. And I'm a drummer. And so I started, and I survived. I dropped one class, but I passed a couple others. And then after that, it was just downhill. I would start a semester with a full load, and then I would stop going to my classes, and I would get W's, like withdrawals. And then I'd start another semester, and I'd stop going, I get W's. But I could pay, in my job, my work in the summertime, I was a house painter. I could pay my entire year's tuition by working 6 weeks in the summertime. So it didn't really matter that I dropped out every quarter, right? There were quarters, because it didn't really cost anything. It was irrelevant. But I did that my second year. The third year, I transferred to a 2-year community college because I thought, well, listen, I'm never going to graduate college, but maybe I'll learn something here. So I took this 2-year business management courses because I was a house painter and I was starting a company. And I thought, well, maybe it'll help me in my company. I found out pretty quickly that wasn't the case. And so I stopped going to my classes. But on my way to the last class, man, the last class, I'm walking. This is exactly how it was, man. I'm walking down to the class and I passed the library and I went, it. And I went into the library and I started doing what I did at the library, which is like just roaming around looking at books because I just love books. And I found these journals and an article. And I found this article on prisons. It was like a social work article. And for the first time in my life, I'm reading it and I was like, damn, I would be really cool to be in a prison. I mean, working, not being in a prison, but that would be cool. It depends on the situation, right? So I went to the phone. There was a phone on the wall, and I went and I picked it up and I talked to the operator and I said, hey, can I talk to the social work department? And I said, and I talked to some dude. I said, can I come over and talk to you about social work degree? So he said, yeah, come over right now. So I went back to the main campus. I signed up for social work classes. But my first quarter back, so this would be in January of 1980, I took a sociology class. And then I got serious. Like, I quit my job, I quit everything, and I decided I was going to become a serious student. So I got 2 C's and 2 D's. I worked my arse off, man. I got 2 C's and 2 D's. That's how bad of a student I was. Like, I didn't know how to study. I didn't know anything. But I was like, okay, that's cool. 2 C's and 2 D's. That's better than W's, right? Because C's earn degrees. You know what I mean? C's earn degrees. So, and I took a sociology class, and the sociology class was so fascinating that I just kind of switched over to sociology. And then that was it. And I never looked back. And that's how I got here. And I'm still love everything about thinking, but I don't like the busy work. Now, what's important for you to know is I also don't think that you should engage in busy work. Like, why do you want to write notes? Why do I want to give you information that, you know, you can get on your cell phone? Yeah, any question that you would want to ask me about, like, well, can you explain racism to me? Or can you explain the different racial groups or whatever? I'm like, look it up on your phone, man. Don't ask me. Like, why would you ask me? And then take the word of just one human being, especially me of all people. Like, you don't want to ask me anything. Look it up on your phone. Mr. Google knows a lot. So why would I do any of that in here? Why would you pay all the money that you're paying to have me go to Mr. Google and like find a bunch of shit, put it on a PowerPoint slide, and then come in here and read the PowerPoint slide and have you write notes down, and then have you like spit it back on an exam and then get to the end of the semester and go, okay, I got my grade in social 119. It's like, why would you pay for it? I should be arrested if I did that. Like, that's criminal. So, like, why would you do that? And so you don't want to do that. And so I try to do for you what I would want to have done for me if I was in this class. And that this is a class on race, culture, and ethnicity. I mean, both half in the United States and half globally. And let me tell you, there's nothing more except everything, but race, culture, and ethnicity are so fascinating that why would you want to waste your time in a class just writing stuff down from a slide and memorizing it? No, you want to engage. And so that's why we work the class the way we do, okay? So you should thank me for that. Also, thank me for the fact that there are no books that you have to buy, which is awesome too. It's a sociology class. Most sociologists tend to be more liberal. I'll explain why that, how that is in later. It doesn't really matter, but most of us are. And there's a reason for that, and it makes a lot of sense when you sort of look at it. People assume, oh, I'm a guy, I'm teaching about race relations, and so I'm at Penn State, and Penn State's a pretty liberal institution, because it is, by the way, pretty liberal here. And they assume that you're going to make the assumption that I'm liberal, right? And it's like, dudes, don't walk down that path. My perspectives are going to come all from all over the place. And I'm neither liberal nor conservative nor anything. I mean, I'm practically mentally ill. But beyond that, it's not there. So you're going to hear, if you want to hear liberal ideas, then you're going to hear them. If you want to hear conservative ideas, you're going to hear them. People who are more conservative in this class will think, oh, I'm too liberal. And people who are more liberal in this class think I'm too conservative. Right now, it seems like I'm hearing, you know, I'm getting a lot of reaction back, the past couple of years anyway, on campus. A lot of the more liberal students think that I'm way too conservative and I need to pick up the liberal cause a little bit, right? And then people who are conservative think I'm obviously way too liberal. And so it's like, I guess I win, right? Because I guess I win. That means it's good. That means I'm hitting things from multiple sides. So, yeah. The goal of 119, it's not to get you to think like me. First, I don't even know what I think. My opinions change every day. They're constantly, people ask me what I think about X, Y, or Z. It just depends on what side of the bed I get up on in the morning. I really, honestly, am constantly changing my thoughts about a wide range of things. I don't know what I think. I just throw stuff out. My goal is not to get you to do that. Well, it is to get you to do that, right? Obviously, to confuse you. And we'd probably have a better world if more of us realized or had the idea that we didn't really know what we thought, that we'd have no idea what's going on. Because it's like, how do you know what's going on on the other side of the world, if you're not on the other side of the world? I don't even know what's happening on the other side of campus because I'm not on the other side of campus. How the hell am I going to figure something out about homelessness or inequality or how bad racism is or whether, you know, we live in a racist police state or whether something like, I don't know, Black Lives Matter is good or bad, or should we build a wall? Should we not build a wall? Should the wall be 4 feet high or 40 feet high? Or like, I don't know. Like, I don't know. How am I going to know any of that? The world's really complicated. So the best that I can do is walk through the world, taking in as much information as I possibly can about all of these things and being fair about where I get that information, meaning that I'm not just selecting things from like one source, and then confusing myself as much as possible. That's the ideal way to walk through the world. And then maybe one day on my deathbed, I'll figure something out and then I'll finally say, Eureka, I got it. Maybe. But probably not. The goal of this class is A, to not be a complete idiot. That's not always easy because when I'm standing up here talking about things that are immensely complex, anybody who studies these things on a regular basis is going to poke holes into everything that I'm saying. And I'm not an expert on anything. Like, how can I be an expert? Do you know how much there is to learn? Like, for example, over the holiday break, I was in Iraq, and my wife and I. And, you know, I study Iraq. I lived through the war. Like, I read all the time about so many things. I do a lot of work in the Middle East. I'm just really, and I was discovering things every day that, just like, oh my God, how did I not know this? How did I never think about this? How is it possible this escaped me? And only because I was over there. And things that if I was here and I never went, and let alone I never thought about these issues, I'd be throwing opinions out that would just be totally stupid. So my goal is to not be a complete moron. I accept the fact that I'm a moron, or that I say dumb things or ignorant things or whatever much of the time. But I don't want to be completely stupid. So I try to back it off as much as possible, but I'm going to say just enough to be confusing, either to myself or to you. And so, you know, if you say X, I'll say Y, right? If you want to swim this way, I'm going to say swim this way. It doesn't really matter. I'm just going to throw things out to get you to have to confront things that, who knows, I don't know. Dude, and by the way, this shit's life and death for people, y'all, right? Like, this is life and death. So I say, do we live in a, are the police, like, do we have, how deep is racism embedded in our, you know, law enforcement institutions? You know, to some of us, you know, you can just sort of sit back and say, oh, I don't know. Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I don't know. Let me think about that. But for other people, yo, that's life and death. This is serious. So, you know, what's happening? Sometimes, you know, I listen to people just prognosticating about what we should do in the Middle East or anything. I don't know any number of things. Like, come on, no, this is serious. You're like, is the Me Too movement good or is it bad? Or is it does more harm than good? It's like, come on, man, stop for a second. What are we talking about? What experiences are we talking about? How this is real. It's not just something that we just randomly think about. So anyway, the goal of this class is A, to confuse you enough that you'll be inspired to either in the key moments say, I don't know, as opposed to just put some idea out into the room, wherever you are. Or B, to actually go out and try to figure stuff out. Because, I don't know, it's because it's cool. Right? It's cool. Learn it. School's cool. So no, school sucks. Right, school is like prison. Basically, you sit, you go to class, you just like, dude, am I right? It's prison, dude. It's terrible. You just like, you go, you show up, it's just, think about kindergarten. They ring a bell, and then you go to kindergarten. It starts on day one. They ring a bell, and then you sit in a circle. And then they ring a bell, and we say, okay, gather around the piano. We're going to sing a song. And then they ring a bell again, and you say, okay, now we're going to go play. And they ring a bell. They're like rats. And you just keep ringing bells, and we just keep doing it. And we're still doing it. It's like we ring a bell, and you say, okay, I got to go to my class. We ring a bell, I got to go do this assignment. And then you just keep doing it, and eventually you have a degree. And then eventually maybe you get a job. And then eventually it's like you get to be my age, and you wonder, what the hell did I do with my life? And then you die. But learning is cool. Do not equate learning with school, man. All right, cool?
All right, so let's do this. Let's do what we do. Let's do a case study. I would like to invite a couple people who could volunteer for us, right? Someone who's a native Mandarin speaker and someone who's a native Korean speaker. Now, we need just an average white guy, just for, it doesn't have to be a white guy, just an American, actually. It doesn't have to be a white guy. Black, brown, whatever the case is. Anybody, who else wants to volunteer? Dude, you want to volunteer? Sure. You're on, man. All right. And then someone who's Arab or speaks Arabic. All right, so introduce yourself. Where are you from?
Hi, I'm Mina. I'm from Egypt.
Oh, Egyptian Arabic, even better. Okay. All right. Cool, man. Mina? Yeah. Okay. Go ahead. Pass it down.
Hi, I'm Omar, and I'm from New York.
Omar from New York. What's your ancestry?
My mom's Peruvian. My dad's Turkish.
Oh, very cool. Oh, dude. Awesome, man. Okay.
Hi, I'm Samantha. My Korean name is Soyoung, but I usually go by Samantha, and I'm from South Korea.
Where are you from in South Korea?
Seoul.
Seoul? All right.
So my name is Mu Chang, and I go by MC. Apparently, I'm from China.
Dude, MC, man. Yeah. Wait, so you speak Mandarin or
Mandarin?
I assume Mandarin.
I can't speak Cantonese. It's
okay,
too
yeah. All right. All right, so listen, man. Here's what you have to do. You all are going to go out in the hallway, and the two of you are going to learn to say some things. And do you have your phone with you?
Yes.
You have your phone with you? Okay. You're gonna have to say three phrases in both Mandarin and Korean. Okay. They're going to teach you how to say them. Okay. And these are the three phrases. And what you want to do is you want to probably do. So we're going to just go on with class while you guys are busy. And you probably want to do it phonetically, like use your phone and, you know, you don't have to memorize them because that's just not going to be possible, but you can do it phonetically. You write them in a way. Do you speak Spanish, bro? Okay. Well, you could do it however you want to do it. So that you can say them so the things sound exactly like they're going to teach you how they sound, all right? Are we cool? You got that? You think you can do it? You think you can teach them to do this? All right, man. Okay. All right. Nisha will take you out in the hallway. And you guys just work on it out there. So again, you too, you're going to have to do it like phonetically, right? You got to write it in a way like some weird, write it however you need to write it to make the sound exactly like you need to make the sound. Does that make sense? All right, man. Three more volunteers, right? Another Korean speaker and another Mandarin speaker. And then just somebody else. Anybody else, man? Dude, how about you? You want to volunteer? Thanks for volunteering. Thanks, man. Thanks. You want to introduce yourself?
So I'm Alex, and I'm from Taiwan.
Alex from Taiwan. Okay. Wait, do you speak Cantonese or Mandarin?
I speak Mandarin and Taiwanese a bit.
Wait, who speaks Mandarin? Wait, now we need another Mandarin speaker. You don't have to come up. Just like who speaks Mandarin? Dude, you fluent? All right, dude. What's your name? Patrick? All right, man. Say, Taiwanese sounds really different than Mandarin in Taiwanese, in your native language.
Could you try something else?
All right, something else.
I understand it, but like.
Okay, how about this? wait, can we get. Wait, you're Taiwanese? Dude, are you Chinese? Do you mind if I... Dude, say Taiwan is its own nation. All right, say this then. Say Taiwan... Wait. Say Taiwan is...
I'll say Taiwan is good.
Taiwan is an awesome place to live. Hold the mic close, too.
Yeah, let me think.
Taiwan is a good place. I kind of forgot
how place.
You didn't get any of that? Dude, say any. What do you want to say? Just start saying anything.
Li Jiababwe.
Do you know that? What's that? Sounds like Cantonese. Yeah, it sounds like Cantonese to you. Say something else. Say your full name.
What do you mean?
And that's how you would say it in... that's in Taiwanese. Is that how you would say it in Mandarin? Say it in Mandarin.
我叫张永明.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. All right, hang on. Do that again. Say it in Taiwanese. Say it in Taiwanese first, and then say it in Mandarin, your name.
我叫张永明.
Oh, damn, dog. That's really different. Did that sound different to you? You understand the Mandarin. Yeah. Okay, all right, man. So one of those names is your name. But what do you go by, Patrick? Here?
Oh, Alex. All right. Alex. Oh, the other guy was Patrick. I don't know. Okay. All right, man. Alex. How'd you pick Alex, by the way? Talk in the microphone.
Oh,
so... Like, how'd you get Alex?
I forgot. I think someone just called me Alexander, then I just call myself Alex.
Yeah? I've always wanted to give someone a name, so... All right, bro. Okay, cool. Thanks, man. Bro, what's your name?
My name's Henry.
Henry?
Yes.
Dude, Henry. You look like a Henry. You know what I mean? With a turtleneck. You got the whole thing going. Where are you from?
I'm from Pittsburgh.
From Pittsburgh? Yeah? Yeah, right. Okay. And what year are you?
I'm a sophomore.
Yeah, what do you study?
Finance?
All right, man. Okay, thanks, bro.
I'm Stella.
Stella?
Yeah.
What's your Korean name?
It's Chayong.
Chayong?
Yeah.
And where did you get from? Who named you Stella? Where'd you get Stella?
Well, it was from the English teacher in Korea. He was just like one of those, just one day they were like, let me give you an English name. I was like, okay.
So you didn't have a name before he gave it to you?
I was just Chayong. But he was like, let's just make up an English name for you.
Which is not, which is pretty common,
yeah.
Right? The reason it's common because, wait, say your full name. Yeah, your full Korean name.
Oh Chayong.
Oh
Chayong.
Chayong.
Yeah, it's O as in Oh.
Oh Chayong.
Chayong. Jayoung. Yeah.
So it's like a lot of names. Like you get tired of people butchering your name, and also right, people get tired of
that. They would say Jayoung a lot.
Jayoung. Yeah. Like bro, Alex, your name. I mean, wait, say it in Mandarin again.
Zhang Youming.
Yeah, so Alex, dude. I'm just going to call you Alex. Because I can try calling you by your Chinese name, but it's just I'm going to just butcher it every time. Like, so for me, wait, say my name, bro. S-A-M.
Oh, Sam, right, sorry.
Wait, say it again.
Sam.
No, it's Sam.
Sam.
Yeah. No. Dude, say my name.
Sam.
Oh, okay, you got... Yeah, no, the reason I say that is because we have this, I don't want to play into this trope of English speakers or Americans or whatever, we can't pronounce other names. It's everyone struggles with names. I mean, that's the nature of it, and that's what's cool, and that's one of the reasons we're just starting out with this case study is just to break down some barriers, you know what I mean? And so, people rarely pronounce my name the way I pronounce it growing up in the Midwest, right? Which is Sam, and people some or something, right? But it's never, which is fine. I don't mind. You can call me anything you want. It doesn't really matter. But the point being, it's a very simple name, S-A-M, and people don't necessarily get it right. Bro, let me ask you a question. What do you know about Koreans and Chinese?
Not too much. I mean, I don't really spend too much time around Koreans or Chinese people. So, but I don't know. I know that's as much as I'll say.
Well, say something. Tell us, give us something that you know.
Well,
true.
Okay. I guess one thing that's...
You can pick one, too, by the way.
Pardon?
No, go ahead.
I guess Chinese people... I think you know what I'm going to say. Chinese people are pretty good at math, generally. They're pretty good at math.
That guy's pretty good at math. Yeah? Pretty good at math.
Yeah.
Bro, Alex, is that true?
Yeah, that's definitely true.
Korean people make good food as well.
Korean people make good food, but Koreans are there any Chinese in here who are bad at math? I mean, there's got to be. Is there anybody who's bad at math? Dude, seriously? There's one, by the way. All right?
Sorry, man.
That's the one guy at Penn State. He's an art history major because he flunked out of base. All right. Are you the only one in class who's bad at math? Anyone else? Dude. All right, dude. That guy, too. All right. Anyway, that's okay, though. That's good. It's a general. It tends to be more true than less true. Would you say that's true about Koreans?
Yeah, generally. They make a whole trend out of it. Making new recipes and all that.
Oh, about food. Oh, yeah. You're back in food. Yeah. Okay. We're going to do some Korean food stuff in here, by the way. What do you know about Korea besides food?
I don't know. I watch a bit of soccer, so I know that Sun Heung-min. Whenever I hear Korea, that's pretty much like what I'll think about usually. And other than that, I know. I mean, Seoul is a pretty cool city. So I'd say that's pretty much all I know about Korea. I don't know too much.
Okay, man. What did you? Let me ask you this question. Do you have any? You don't have any Korean or Chinese friends?
Yeah. No.
Yeah. What do you think is one of the biggest misconceptions about Korea? How long have you been here in the U.S.?
I was here since 13 years old.
Oh, 13 years old. Yeah. That's why you said my name in the way that you did.
Yeah.
Sam.
I grew up in Oklahoma.
In Oklahoma?
Yeah.
Do you have a southern accent? Can you do a southern accent?
Hey, y'all.
That was good.
Grab me a root beer.
Root beer. All right, I like that. What do you think one of the biggest misconceptions about Korea that you've heard while here?
That everyone in Korea is like, you know, K-pop level hot, I guess. I don't know. Or like, I don't know, like he just said about like math, like I'm pretty dog shit at math too, so.
Yeah, Koreans really match Chinese with math. Yeah, okay. What do you think is one of the big misconception about China? Where are you from in China, by the way?
I'm from Taiwan.
Oh, Taiwan. Well, if you could live in, dude, if you could live in China, where would you want to live? All right, Taiwan. Wait, I thought Taiwan and China were the same place, by the way. All right, just sorry about, dude. Did I do all right there? I'm trying to. All right. Dude, where are you? Are you from Taipei?
Yeah, my family used to live in Taichung, but we moved to Taipei a few years ago.
What is the coolest thing about living in Taipei?
The food.
The food?
So much better than America.
Dude. So now you gotta like move forward. Yeah. Any other Taiwanese here in class? Any other Taiwanese in class? All right. Anyone been to Taiwan? Would you agree? Food's killer? Yeah. Where are you from? Where's your ancestry from? Oh, dude, awesome, man. Okay, well, you have one fan up here. So food. Any misconceptions about Taiwan? Other than...
That we have small eyes, probably.
Do you have small eyes? Yeah? What is that misconception, by the way? Bro, have you thought about that?
Yes.
Oh, you have?
Hey, dude. Everyone has.
What do you mean? When you think a Taiwanese said, hang on, we're working something out here. Like, dude, when you say that, first off, take your glasses off. Can you get a close-up? We're gonna test this out. I don't think your eyes are that small. Wait, hey, Junho, can we fix the, we need it to be brighter. All right, bro, hang on. Damn. Hey, Wesley. Oh, Wesley's going to fix it. Hang on. We got to fix the camera. Bro, when you say Taiwanese, but Taiwanese, Southeast Asian, right? East Asians have small eyes. What are you talking about?
I say because you asked me if I thought about that. That's just a general stereotype of Asian.
No, I got you. Yeah. I got you. Yeah, I'm not thinking you're not. Well, this is, by the way, people, this is one of those moments when like Henry would be like, oh my God, Henry's so racist. It's like that. I wouldn't have asked him that question. I knew what he meant, and we're talking here. So that was an example of me not doing a gotcha moment with Henry. Okay, is that cool? You did, even if you felt that, right? Yeah, you're fine. I would never do it. All right. So listen, man. So when you say small, what do you mean small? Like smaller in the socket, or smaller in like? What do you mean small?
I don't know. I think it's just a general misconception that. Taiwanese people have small eyes.
Yeah. All right. Stella.
Yeah.
Is that a misconception? Or is that a conception?
Oh, it used to be back in the day, I think. But
what do you think? What do you mean when people say small? What do they mean small?
I think it's more like kind of like the eyelids are more like closer and like
yeah.
They're more like, I don't know, like spread sideways or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah. So like, listen, if you have, if you compare the skull of Alex and Henry, their eye sockets are the same. Like their eyeballs are the same. It's just that, you know, there's an eye fold in the eye that can come down for East Asians a little bit more. And it's like the epicanthic eye fold. We'll talk about it later in class, but it's just that little flap right here in the corner of the eye that just kind of pulls the upper lid down a little bit. So it means it's like a little bit more narrow in that way as opposed to being really wide. So, yeah, so that's what it is. So when you say small, like that's what's really important. Small eyes, because when I think eyes, I think of the eyeball and the eye socket. This is just the skin around the eyes. And so, all right, so listen. So here's what we're going to do. So you guys, can you just come stand over here for a second? And oh wait, I'm going to need two of these. So you can hold on to, you can guys face this way. All right, can you like just come over here a little bit? All right, man. You too, right here. All right, so now, bro, they're gonna say what they're supposed to say. Your job is to see how good they are, who does a better job at speaking either Korean or Mandarin. And your job, we're gonna start with Omar, and Omar is gonna say something. We don't say whether you're gonna say it in Korean or Mandarin, okay? You're just gonna say one first and then the other second. All right, and then you have to decide, is he speaking Korean or is he speaking Mandarin, okay?
So I choose one?
No, we'll do the first one and then do the second one. Come on, bro, you got this, man.
So either one?
Ano ho zayo. Daja ho.
Okay, the whole thing?
Yeah, I just said both.
That was it?
Yeah.
Wait, you're supposed to teach them three things. Oh, you did them all? Say it again.
Ana hazayo. Dajaho.
Okay, do the next one now.
All right.
Tonin Omar Imenda. Wosher Omar.
Dude, with the first one, was it Korean or Mandarin? First one was Korean? Uh-huh. And the second one was Mandarin. Okay? All right, dude. You just do, hang on. Don't do it, don't necessarily do Korean the Mandarin. You can, but you may not, okay? All right. Okay, bro, listen up.
Okay. Mohaseyo. Niminzamiya.
Okay, do the next one. Yeah, do the.
That was, yeah, I did one. I did that first one. I did that one
after. Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That was everything?
Yeah.
Okay, do the first one again.
Mohaseyo.
Second one?
Niminzamiya.
Is the first one Korean or?
I think the first one's Korean.
All right, man. Dude, did you understand anything? Did the two of you understand anything that either of them said? What did they say in Mandarin?
One of them said, "Hi everyone, my name's Omar." The other, I did not understand.
Wait, did you also teach him to say, how are you?
Yeah, I did. Yeah,
Which one was the last one?
Okay. Yeah.
I thought.
Do I say it again?
Yeah, do that one.
Do you want him to do this?
Yeah, do that one.
All right. Yes. Kikume do the last lider bijao. Oh, kikume lider baiju. That's one.
And do the other one.
And then the other one. Soju hanjan tuseyo.
Dude, what did he say?
I heard soju.
The first, you didn't hear any Mandarin there? Do the Mandarin one again.
Mandarin one again, I got you. Kekumen lider baju.
Kekumen lumba baju?
No.
Did you understand it?
Did I say it wrong?
Dude, don't, hang on, bro.
I said it again.
Don't let,
I keep saying it.
They didn't understand a damn thing you said, but don't let that discourage you, right? Remember how difficult Arabic is, right? Do the Korean one.
Soju hanjan tuseyo.
What'd he say? Wait, can you give her the mic? What'd he say?
Can I get a glass of soju?
Oh, dude, awesome, man. All right, can you say that one?
Oh, does that
the soju one, yeah.
Soju hanjan tuseyo.
That was Yeah, very good.
Pretty good?
Yeah.
So if he went into a restaurant or a bar in Korea, they'd know what he was saying.
Yeah, I think they will understand, yeah.
Dude, do the Mandarin one. Come on, man. You got to hold it. No, Omar, do the Mandarin one. That's MC here.
깨끗한 라이더 바이죠.
Say it again.
깨끗한 라이더 바이죠.
Did you understand, bro? What's that? Did he say what?
He said baijiu. That's white wine.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like... Is that what it's supposed to say? Baijiu. Yeah. It's baijiu. So you understood that?
I heard baijiu.
That's all? You heard baijiu? What's the second one, man?
Kekumer leider. And then baijiu. Kekumer leider baijiu.
Kekumer leider baijiu.
Yeah! Yeah! Damn, dude. All right. Awesome, man. All right. I need four volunteers. Hang on. First off, I need two people in the front, don't turn around because I don't want you to see. I don't want anyone to see who raised their hand. I need two international students. Then I need two more people. So give me somebody in the back. How about, if this is actually fun. Okay, one. And I need a guy. Just to, wait, hang on. Bro, you. All right, come on. You're Americans, right? Dude, you're an American? Dude, Donald Trump. All right. All right, y'all, you're going to come out here. Don't trip on this. Okay, you can just get to know each other. Don't. Okay, listen, so I need, where's the suite? Yeah, I need you. All right, now I need four international students. Now I need four people who kind of look like these folks. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have them come out. First the international students, then the American students, and see if they can pick out who is and is not domestic-born American and who is international. Okay? Who's international and who's American of this lineup of people? Wait, first off, what's your name, bro?
I'm Jad, J-A-D.
Where are you from?
I'm Lebanese.
You're Lebanese? Wait, what's your name?
Jad.
Jad?
J-A-D, Jad.
Jad.
It's like God Jad. With a J.
Yeah, no, I got you. You know, as soon as I looked at you, I was thinking, God. You look like Jesus. Yo. Jesus probably looked like, except Jesus was a lot shorter. Jesus was probably, they estimate Jesus was 5'2", you know. That's about that short. And maybe weighed like 100 to 105 pounds. So people have this idea that Jesus is going to return. I don't know, some of you Christians do. Jesus is going to return to earth. He's going to be a big guy with a big movie. He's going to be a little dude, probably with a little high squeaky voice. You're like, hi, I'm Jesus. And you're going to be like, get the fuck out of here. No, you're not. All right. Okay, dude.
Can I ask some questions?
No, you can't. They can't speak because that'll be a giveaway. What's your name, by the way?
Nikki.
Nikki? Hang on. Just, we're going to leave Nikki. We're not going to go. Jed?
Jod.
Jod.
Yeah.
Jod. And Nikki. Okay, go down the lineup. Who is and is not? Wait, before... You can can't cheat off of each other.
Can I know their names at least?
No, you can't know their names, dude.
American. American.
Wait, you got to talk into the mic.
Oh, okay. So the first three are American.
Wait, hang on. Stop right there. What would you say? No, hang on. We're going to go. Huh? Don't pay attention to anything he's saying. Go ahead. Keep going.
International.
Mm-hmm.
International. International. American and international.
Okay, international, American, international, international, American, international,
yeah.
American, American, American. Got it. All right, Nikki.
International, American, American, international, international, American, American, American.
He's American? American, American? Okay, so what are you looking at? Wait, American, American. What's he?
American.
American? He's international? What makes him international and him not?
Oh, no, it's just a feeling.
Just what?
Just a feeling.
What do you know, look at it? Look at their shoes, man. Girl, did you say they were both international?
Yes.
But what do you, what makes them international? Like, what are you looking at? Talk right into the mic.
Like, I don't know, because they look like they're from another country. I don't know.
Do you think America, we don't have Chinese or Asian people?
No, like, I went to an international high school, so like we had like 70 different nationalities, so I was always around people with like different nationalities.
So, like,
I can just look
hair?
At the face and be like, he's not American, you know?
Okay, wait, he's American though?
Yeah, I think so.
What makes him American? So.
His boots.
Yeah. Wait, can we... Bro, yeah, get a shot of those boots, okay. He has the same damn boots you have on, man. You're an international student.
I've never seen those anywhere. Like,
yeah, you're right.
In America, you know?
Yeah, I got you, man. I got you. All right. And wait, so you said he is American?
International.
He's inter. What makes him international?
It's still just a feeling.
A feeling?
Yeah.
Bro, what you said he's American.
I was like, I think he's international. Honestly.
You think he's international? Why?
He looks kind of like European, you know? Like maybe Italian.
Kind of look
Swedish, maybe. You know?
Swedish. Dude, hang on, my friend. What does a Swedish person look like?
They're all blonde.
They're all blonde.
And I think they have blue eyes.
Blonde with blue eyes.
I don't know.
Dude, he's not blonde and he doesn't have blue eyes, man. Simon, is he a friend of yours, by the way? All right, just wondering. Okay, he will be, dude. You got to hang out with Simon right here. He'll put you straight. I'm telling you. Okay, so hang on. So, wait, like her? Well, you said she's American.
No, I said she's international.
Yeah, where's she from?
Or actually, I did say she's American.
You did say she's American, but she has blonde hair. So why isn't she Swedish?
I don't know. Like, not only Americans have blonde hair.
I hear that. All right. And so you said, what did you say about these two guys?
International and American.
International and American. What's the difference between them? No, you said, really, what are you looking at?
I guess probably the skin tone. It's like, one is a bit... Well, slightly.
No, skin tone. Go ahead. Yeah, what are you looking at? No, come here and look at him. What are you looking at?
I feel like he's more pale, and then he's more tanned, like just slightly, just like a little difference.
Yeah. Okay. All right. And what about her? What'd you say about her?
International.
What makes her international?
Because she has brown hair.
Oh my God! Really? This is it?
It's not just.
So
hair.
Wait. Oh my God! All right. Okay, dude, this is how life is. This is Social Run. Welcome to Social Run 18. All right, hang on a second. All right, y'all. Come on out. All right, so here's what you have to do. Can you not Jod, not Jod, and not Nikki. Nikki, right? Okay, but who is... international and who's American? Domestic born American. No, you can decide on your own. Go ahead, you can go.
American. American, international. Let's go American, international, American. Maybe a soccer player, maybe international.
Dude, a soccer player?
American soccer player or international. Like, you can't, like, one to two. International, let's go with that.
Wait, we'll choose one.
All right, the only people who wear all Adidas are, like, soccer players who are American.
Yeah? And what about, like, frat guys?
I'm going frat guy, American. I'm going to go international on Adidas, dude.
International on the... Where do you think he's from?
I'm going to go with Europe.
Just Europe. Okay, come on. All right. Pick a country, my friend. You can't just say
Let's
Europe.
Go with...
Europe's a big place. Sweden.
I'm going to go with say... Denmark. I like
Denmark? Yeah. All right, dude, Denmark. All right, go ahead.
I'm going to say international.
International?
Yeah.
What makes this guy international?
Nothing.
What's that?
I don't know. I'm just guessing.
No, don't guess. Look at him. Look at those Walmart boots, for example.
No, I don't even see your boots.
Oh, you gotta look. Look at her. Go ahead. All right, go ahead. This guy.
International American.
International American.
Yeah.
What's the difference between these two guys?
He has a lot of really cool jewelry.
Wait, hold the mic close.
He has a lot of really cool jewelry on.
All right. And that makes him international?
I didn't see. You were hiding.
No, let me see. Let her see your jewelry. Yeah, look at this guy.
Yeah.
Total history. He's got an earring.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, her?
American. I'm going to say international for him, too.
Yeah, where do you think he's from?
Maybe like Italy.
What makes her American?
I don't know.
Go ahead. Dude, do you get you
like
guess
it's hard to tell for this kind of thing.
Yeah, it's hard to tell.
Yeah.
Dude, bro, what's your name again?
August.
Ah, I never asked you your name. Your name is August. The month August. What's your name?
Rowan.
Rowan?
Yeah.
Okay. What did you say for her? Why'd you say international? Speak into the mic.
I don't know. The all black and the shoes are kind of funky.
The shoes are funky?
I mean, just the places I've been in Europe, like, a lot of the people have, like, an aesthetic. Like, they're all wearing all black or all white or all gray a lot of the time.
Yo, so Kadir, can you make sure you get a shot of her shoes?
You know, if you go into Zara or something, it's all, like, monochromatic.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I got you, dude. Okay, well, let's shoot for it. You ready?
Yeah.
All right, man. What's your name? Where are you from?
Kylie. I'm from Rochester, New York.
Kylie is a total American name. All right.
It's actually Australian.
Australian? All right, Mike.
I think.
Eric, I'm from outside Philly.
Outside Philly.
Dan, I'm from Philly.
Dude, oh, how'd you do? All right. Go ahead, man.
Michael, Shanghai.
Shanghai. Wait. Okay, go ahead.
Elise, Amsterdam.
Isabella. Dude, you got one right. Go ahead.
I'm from Sweden.
Wait, can you say that again? What's your name again?
Isabella.
Isabella from Sweden?
I'm from Sweden.
How do you say I'm from... Can you say it in Sweden? I'm from Sweden.
Jag är
Sweden.
Från Sverige.
Wait, say it into the mic.
Jag är från Sverige.
Did you get that? That's very international. I'm asking, how would you know that she's American? Ah, she has blonde hair. All right.
My name's Russell. I am from Hamden, Connecticut. CT.
I'm Laith. I'm from Jordan.
From Jordan. This is like, do you speak the same? This is your guy. He's one country over, you know what I mean? Good. All right. Exactly. Damn. So are you Christian or Muslim?
Muslim.
You're Muslim?
Yeah.
And are you Christian or Muslim? You're from Lebanon, right?
Like a mix of both.
Mix of both? Yeah? All right. Yeah, we're all a mix of both anyway. All right, man. So we have the Jordanian guy, Swedish, Dutch, and what'd you say? China, from China. Yeah. So here's the thing, right? This is day one, so we're just sort of have. I'm just trying. What I'm trying to do is just break stuff down a little bit to get us used to this. In normal life, in this world, especially in the United States now, it becomes. There's this thing about, I don't know, like focusing on features, right? Talking about things, like asking people, like, let's say you're African American. Do you identify as African American, by the way? Wait. Who's just got a microphone? Wait, you identify as black?
I feel like the term African-American is kind of... It's like it's purposely pointing out that we're not from here, whereas white people just could be white or Caucasian. And it, like, that is a region, but I feel like if white people can be white, I can just be black. No one has to... If we're all Americans now, why do we need to, like, remind people where we're from originally when we should all be Americans now?
So. Dude. All right. Dude. Go for it. I'm sure. Exactly. All right. So the goal is these things are what I want us to start doing and throughout the semester is really focusing on things that we see in people. Focusing on the, I don't know, it's like to ask whether some where someone's from and if they're international, and like the fact that you would say, ah, look at the shoes. It's like, yeah, pay attention to this stuff. Because when you start paying attention, you learn lots of things about a lot of people, and including we learn things about us. The best way to learn about ourselves is to travel. If you want to learn about your own culture, you travel. But a lot of times you can't travel, right? But we can here, because I can travel just by meeting people from other places. And so as I travel, I'm looking at shoes. I'm like, yeah, like, you're, are this, where are those shoes from, by the way?
Vagabond.
Vagabond? In, you bought them in Sweden or here?
It's a British brand.
It's a British brand?
British brand.
Yeah, all right. Wait, Swedish? Man, I'm going to have to get used to your accent. All right. It's cool. Okay, so it's a Swedish brand. You see that? Like, this is the thing. Just, so the goal in here is to start paying attention to these kinds of cultural differences, because it's cool. Because we do live in a big world, man. It's a big, massive world. And there are people here in this classroom from all over the world. And so we're going to talk about all this stuff. And oftentimes talk about the things that we're not supposed to talk about. It's not that we're not supposed to talk about, but it's that we... I don't know, somehow we don't want to offend people, or we don't want to come off in some way, or it just feels weird, and I don't know. You know what I mean? Especially in the United States. Like, we have learned in the United States to be really... Yeah, we don't. Nobody wants to offend anybody. It's like, you can't engage in the world of race relations if you don't take risks to offend people. And so what if people get offended? Like, whatever. It's like, get on with it. All right. Any of you have any questions? Do you have a question, bro? All right. Okay, so here's how we operate. First off, thanks for volunteering. This was pretty low-hanging fruit on the volunteer stuff. And